Miles has been a leader not only for the Haida Nation, but for the people of British Columbia, the First Nations people of British Columbia, and indeed across the country and beyond for many, many years. He served as the president in his own community and the Council of the Haida Nation for, I believe it was 12 years. Miles is one of the architects of the process that we're in here today, so it's so appropriate and so heartwarming to keep having him come back and grounding us in where we came from and helping us to think how we can move forward. Miles was on the BC Claims Task Force that actually put together the BC Treaty process that has, you know, we struggled with over the years, but it's gotten us all to where we're at today. He was also Chief Commissioner, served as Commissioner and Chief Commissioner of the BC Treaty Commission, and now is working in his own business. He carries a lot of awards and honours that I'm sure would be difficult to repeat in a short period of time. But Miles, very, very pleased to welcome and looking forward to hearing from you today. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Angela, and good morning to all of you. Thank you to Chief Ian Campbell for that very gracious welcome. We're always made so welcome by our Coast Salish hosts. I'm really honored to have been asked to speak again at this year's BCTC conference on a topic which I think is exactly the right topic for us to be discussing right now on nationhood. You recall last year when we gathered here, we were talking about quote unquote overlaps, which leads us to a discussion on self-definition of our nations, of which territory is a key component, and that we concluded that the only ones who could resolve those issues are ourselves. It wasn't for the Crown in right of Canada or British Columbia to have any front seat role in addressing definition of our territories and what might be disputed or shared. All they could do in the spirit of treaty making is support us in resolving those things, and that's the spirit of nationhood. And then we look at the court cases that have been evolving, you know, mainly since Calder in the 70s, where the courts have increasingly recognized our continued existence as nations and have clarified that the most fundamental laws, the highest laws in Canada, protect that nationhood within the framework of Canada. But there's a struggle going on that I think we need to be aware of. So before I get into it, let me just say, I want to talk for about 30 minutes, and then I want to leave 15 minutes for a discussion. I'm probably going to say some things that some don't like. It's not my intention. I believe, like Chief Joe Mathias, I believe in this treaty process. I'm disgusted with the Crown's positions and preconditions they bring to the table, but I believe negotiating honorable treaties is the way to go. And we designed an appropriate treaty process, and because the other parties aren't living up to their commitments doesn't mean we should be walking away. On the contrary, I think we should be refocusing our efforts. You know, and all the works there, Robert Morales and the Common Table, have done great work on isolating the essential obstacles, the essential issues that we need to overcome to make treaty negotiations work. But if I leave you with one point, I want it to be this: that the most important thing that we need to do to make this new relationship work, to make treaty making a reality, is entirely up to us. It's up to us as the living generation of our nations to own and to define our nationhood. rooted in our histories, but functional in a modern world. That's our responsibility, nobody else's. But think about what nationhood is in its essence. It's not a government program. It's not something that Ottawa or Victoria or any other nation can deliver to us. Nationhood for each of us is a continuing ancient fact of history. It's up to us today to breathe life into that. And I believe if we're going to be effective in court or in negotiations, we need to do the work ourselves to define our nationhood in a modern way. That's tough work. It's a heck of a tough job, especially after 150 years of the relentless forces of colonialism. But only we can do it. Only we can do it. Only us can do it. You know, when you think about nationhood, really think about what it is. Can you be a nation without a degree of sovereignty? I don't think so. I think it's ridiculous to think that nationhood could be bestowed from someone else or negotiated from someone else. Sovereignty is not something that you get from someone else. Sovereignty is something that comes from inside of you. Sovereignty comes from the will to be sovereign. And that's who we are. We know who we are, each of us, as nations. We have to bring that forward, and we're collectives. We need to work with all our people and manifest that in a real way in our lives. So, on the question of your nationhood and whether that continues, only you can determine that. If your nationhood doesn't live in you, in your heart, guiding your actions, then it probably doesn't exist. If you're waiting for somebody to deliver it to you, it ain't gonna happen. You're just gonna be a shadow of them. And the court system up to this time has supported us, because here's the basic struggle that's going on as I see it. It's between two worldviews. One is the nationhood. Let me call them a paradigm. Our worldview as defined by who we are as nations. That's been relentlessly pounded on for 150 years by the other paradigm that's competing and trying to snuff that out. That's what I'd call the colonial paradigm. And we have to make a choice. We have to make a choice which paradigm we empower. Every moment of every day, we have that choice in front of us. And it's going to be a fundamental decision that we make in taking issues to court or negotiating treaties. Last year I talked about what I saw as the evolution of the relationship between Canada and Indigenous peoples. And you know, I think it's particularly important now with the new Prime Minister, the new government, really quite openly and seemingly strongly committing to establishing a nation-to-nation relationship. Let's remember how this relationship evolved, how Canada has evolved in these relationships. I see it in three phases. The first phase was in the colonial period and before the Parliament of Canada was established. leading up to about 1867. In 1763, Britain passed the Royal Proclamation, which is still a part of Canadian law. And that set out, that recognized the nation paradigm, which was the reality amongst First Nations. And when the British came over, that was their promise to our forebears. We're a just people. You'll only lose control over your lands and territories through an agreement, nation to nation, with our crown. We're honorable people. We're going to treat you the right way. We're going to share and coexist in what are your lands. That was their promise, and based on that promise, they signed 14 treaties across this country. Treaties that today, the First Nations signatories see as honorable, except, like in the BC Treaty process, they're not lived up to. You know, there were a lot of horrific things done during that period, but essentially, in terms of government-to-government agreements, they went through the motions of doing the right thing, of dealing with us as nations. And then they changed their mind around the time the Parliament of Canada was put in place. And they decided, and this is what I call phase two, they decided to deny any fundamental entitlements we had as peoples, let alone nations. They totally forgot about any nationhood concept. They decided that we weren't even humans. We weren't even worthy of having rights, but they were going to deny them, and they were going to assimilate our people into the Canadian body politic. One of the first pieces of legislation they put in place was the Indian Act to do that. And that's been what many of us refer to as the dark period of Canada's history, of our relations with Canada. But the third period started, I'd say, with the court cases in the early 70s, when the courts gradually came back to recognizing the reality of our continued existence as nations, and started building a framework in Canadian law for that recognition and for that enactment. And that's where we find ourselves now. You know, the high water mark of that has been the Chilcotin decision, which for the first time recognized a portion of their lands as being protected as Aboriginal title by Canada, but it's a beginning. And I think really importantly there, the court didn't come in and say, Chilcotin, we're recognizing your Aboriginal title and here's what it is, we're going to define it out for you. The Honeyguatine people, the Chilcotin people, went into the court and explained to the court in minute detail what their title is on their own terms. And the court could accept it or reject it, and the court in one part of their territories accepted it. And that was, I think, very powerful. But that's our challenge today, is to define our nationhood in terms of our people and in terms of our territory and the worldview, our particular worldview that binds those together. And many of you have been talking yesterday and over the past whiles about governance and building good, strong, and appropriate modern governance is key to defining that nationhood. So many of you are far down the road in negotiating your own treaties. I know that as each of you have gone to the treaty table, you've wrestled with that question. You've wrestled with your internal organization. You've wrestled with the reality of the Indian Act and its continuing colonial forces in your midst, as you've defined, as you've struggled to breathe life back into your nationhood. But that's a struggle that's yours, that's internal, that you have to win to manifest this. And I believe whether you choose to go to court, whether you choose to just assert through direct action, or whether you choose to negotiate at the treaty table, the key determinant is you, in a strong way, defining your nationhood, breathing life into it, and asserting it. And I think that's the opportunity, as Canada gets serious about coming to nation-to-nation tables. I believe that that's the key work in front of us now. And I remember back to last year's conference. You know, I think it's never too late to do this. Those of you who are getting close to treaty making, many of us remember back to the, when was it, the late 70s, when the James Bay Cree were under great duress, under great pressure to take an agreement, a pretty pretty ugly agreement, I called it, with Canada, which was about seed release and surrender over their territories. Last year, the Crees came to the BC Treaty meeting and reported to you on the progress they've made since then. You know, they may have signed that agreement then, but today they're regaining jurisdiction over a huge portion of their territories in northern Quebec. So in my view, it's never over. It's never over until you give up on your nationhood. And you just got to keep that vision, defining it, keep focused, and keep going forward. And we need to support each other in that work. Let me give you just one example of how I think that can be done. My people are, people often think that the Haida Nation don't have overlaps or disputes with our territory. There are, and one of them is in the ocean area between ourselves and the Heiltsuk. And there are rich fishing grounds in the oceans between us that both our peoples depend on. Anyway, 160 years ago, about the time Canada, before the Parliament came into being, about 15, 20 years before that, our people were warring, and the leaders got sick of fighting over this stretch of ocean. You know, it was serious. People were killing each other, and they said enough. So they came together and made a peace treaty. And what they decided is they said, this line that we've been drawing between our nations, we've looked at it as a line of separation. And in their wisdom, they said, we need each other. We're neighbors. We need to support each other. From now forward, that line is a line of joining. We're going to make a protocol through this treaty on how we're going to share these fishing grounds. And this summer, that treaty has been renewed in awesome potlatches in Haida Gwaii and in Bella Bella, in Heiltsuk. I mean, and that's real. That is very real. If you were in those rooms and saw that, right from the elders to the youth, the commitment as fellow nations to joining, to getting along, it's very real and powerful. And I know there's nothing that's going to stand in the way of that alliance going forward. And if Canada wants to do anything in those areas, in those waters, and you know the pressure that's been on to put pipelines and tankers through the oceans, it's done. It's until our people consent to any of those activities, they're not going to happen. Now our challenge is to spread that out throughout our territories. Imagine if we did that with fisheries. I know that's one of the toughest issues. And, you know, 20 years ago when we were developing the Aboriginal fisheries strategy, we tried to make a treaty, an agreement amongst all the coastal nations on how to share the sockeye. That proved beyond our grasp in those days. And still, we're just responding, reacting to the federal government. If we could figure out how, and we can do it, it just takes the will, how to work together to share all those stocks, whether they're in our territories or traveling between us, that our ownership, which is a part of our nationhood, would be manifested. I have no doubt. Anyway, that's our challenge in moving forward. I don't think the courts can really do any more for us. Any declaration of Aboriginal title is going to have to first come from us. And the courts, once we do that, once we get them to declare those titles, can help us to implement our vision of our nationhood. So I think that's through the Treaty Commission, to the commissioners and to all the participating nations in the process. I think we've got to find ways of working on that over the coming months and years. And I know in many parts of the province you are. But Madam Chair, I want to leave it at that, and I want to have an opportunity to have a dialogue, to have a discussion if anyone wanted to talk more about any of those concepts.
Thanks very much, Miles. Inspiring words, as always, and definitely some food for thought for all of us in the room. Miles is inviting some discussion or questions. Is there anybody who wants to open the floor with a question? You've stunned them all. Here we go.
Good morning. Thank you, Miles, for your words. I really appreciate them. I wonder if you could speak a little further to the agreement the Haida Nation has with the Heiltsuk Nation around the fisheries.
This around fisheries, the herring agreement. Based on the treaty I just talked to you about, the treaty that was first enacted 160 years ago and was renewed over the past couple of years, the Haida Nation and the Heiltsuk Nation and other nations, including the Nuchanalth, have identified herring fisheries as a important part of the food chain, an essential part of maintaining sustainable fisheries in our territories. We've each viewed the DFO's management plan as totally out of sync with reality. That DFO has chosen to manage an industry, not a valuable fishery, which every other fishery and everything else in the ocean is dependent on. So we each chose to focus our management efforts on the herring and have developed, based on our oral traditions, in the Haida oral tradition and the Heiltsuk Gwelas, their oral tradition, have laid out a new approach to management of herring, which is focused on the strength of the stocks and rebuilding them to historical levels, and have framed that out in a protocol, in a herring protocol, and where they work regularly. They each have their own fisheries management teams, their technical teams. They come together and share scientific information as each of them develops increasing detail with this new changed approach to herring management, to flesh it out so that it's credible in scientific eyes, but it's based on our understanding of our traditional values. And it's come a long way, and you know, from for reasons that you'd understand better than I, Leah, the courts have upheld the HIDA, have given us injunctions based on our management activity and scientific work, have given us injunctions against the commercial herring fishing. And many of you will see last year denied one to HELTSEC, and they had to take direct action. That conflict came so close to being catastrophic. I was just thankful that at the 11th hour, cooler heads prevailed. The HELTSEC were committed to stopping that fishery, whatever they had to do. The HIDAs were with them, and I think also the new Chonalth. And if they had to, they said they were going to go out there and start cutting nets, you know, which is tantamount to a declaration of war. They were going to do it. Somehow, DFO officials found some obscure way to shut down the fishery before it came to that. But that commitment was there. That definition of nationhood backed this up. The definition of the herring management plan based on our oral laws, our historical laws, and manifesting that today with the best science was all put in place. Let's see what happens this year. I bet it's going to get much easier. I know Chief Marilyn Sled has told me they already have an agreement with fisheries over the herring for this season. So we're making progress.
Thanks,
but Miles. It takes that effort. It takes the will of the people to make it happen. And you know, the for some reason the commercial fishery has a strong lobby. What are they, about 3 or 4% of the population and a smaller portion of the economy? Why should they have more power than us in those discussions? It's ridiculous. We got to stand up.
Okay, thanks, Miles. We have another question here.
Thank you, Miles. Darren Patrick, Lake Babine Nation. I just want to get your comments on a couple things, and it was brought up yesterday during our breakout group as well. The rhetoric from the government, you know, we're going to recognize you on a nation-to-nation basis. To me, those are just words for the Liberals to have garnered votes. I have hope, but I'm also a very big skeptic. Because the Indian Act and treaties have failed us miserably. They continue to do so. History is, I'm afraid, is just going to be repeating itself. The process itself in granting us rights is not a recognition on a nation-to-nation basis. We still have to ask them for our rights.
Right on.
And That's not recognition. The inherent right as defined in UNDRIP to self-government is something that they are still controlling and able to grant us. That's not a recognition on a nation-to-nation basis. That's not honoring. And I question this, and I've always questioned the treaty process itself, because it is a granting of rights. It's not recognition. It's not a nation to nation sitting across and bargaining on an equal basis. We have to basically beg for everything. And so long as it doesn't undermine their power and their corporations and such, they will be willing to grant it. But from my perspective, they only grant us rights on basically a municipal level. So that's not a nation-to-nation relationship. I'll end it there and ask for your comments. Hawa?
I think you're right on, and it's one of the irritants in my life that you know, we all participated in designing a beautiful, I think it's a still appropriate, treaty process in this province. We had 19 recommendations, 19 principles that were going to guide it, and we're going to enter nation-to-nation negotiations on a mutually designed process. Day one, we go to the table, and they pulled off what you just said. They turned it into a program. Canada and BC made a secret deal. They call it a cost-sharing agreement, where they were each going to put in $100,000 a head to give participating nations $100,000 each worth of land and government services, programs. In return, you gave up your title and rights. That's not what the original bargain was, and when we started the process, everyone was very clear that the BC Claims Task Force report, those principles were the Bible for treaty negotiating. I don't even see it referred to anymore. When Trudeau, the new Prime Minister, made his offer of a nation-to-nation relationship, you know, he has people in his cabinet. Wasn't she here a couple of years ago? Jody Wilson, the Minister of Justice, understands what that means. She understands what nation-to-nation means and what it's going to take to make that commitment real is our nations going to that table as nations. If you go to that table and say, okay, I'm coming to a government-to-government table. On your side is Canada, and here on my side is First Nation X. But I'm coming to you, and you know, I've managed to get elected as a tribal council, but I can't really get along with my band council, and the hereditary chiefs are unreasonable, but we can't sort this all out. You know, I have a territory here, but three other nations are claiming 75% of it also. It's going to be pretty tough for Canada to respond to that on a nation-to-nation basis. And that's just reality. Nation-to-nation is a high standard. Each of us has to be able to sort those issues out. Not perfectly. It doesn't have to be absolute perfection in that definition, but sufficient to meet that threshold of representing a people and a territory with a common worldview and decision-making process. If we can do that, we're going to put their, well, I don't know, feet to the fire is a bit, I don't know why I always use that confrontational language. We're gonna put the pressure on them to live up to their commitments, put it that way. If we can't do that, I'm gonna let them off the hook again. If we can do that, I could only imagine what's gonna happen inside that cabinet and that caucus with Jody and other First Nations there. This is a major, in my view, a major moment, a major opportunity for change. And if it's 22 years after when we expected it was, I guess better late than never. We only need to do it right once in our generation. If we can do it now, why, you know, that would almost make up for the last 22 years.
Thanks, Miles. A question from Alex in the back here.
Yeah, thanks, Miles. Alexander Chartrand from Wikinoch, from the land of the Hamats. I just wanted to use the word paradigm. I couldn't even spell it, so maybe you can spell it out for me. Paradigm. I understand it, but Do you have in your culture, in the Haida Gwaii culture, your way, a symbol that represents a paradigm, the different opposing, I guess that's what it means, opposing conflict type thing within your nation or within within yourself as a person? And thank you for the presentation on the nationhood. I understand it, I believe in it, and I also have what you call a vision, particularly to myself. So my question is the paradigm or the symbol that you use in Haida Gwaii that would represent a paradigm. Do you have that symbol?
I just couldn't think of a better word, that's all. You know, by paradigm, all I mean is basically a worldview, the way a particular worldview is organized. And the nationhood paradigm is much different and has different purposes than a colonial one. The colonial paradigm is intended to absorb us, to snuff us out. That's what it's doing as peoples. You know, and just make us everyday taxpaying Canadians or whatever makes a Canadian. That's what they're trying to do. Do away with Awikino citizens. Do away with Haida citizens. Make them Canadians. Do away with this question. The nationhood paradigm are the principles of them accepting, as the judge said in Delgamuukw, we're all here to stay. Haidas, Gitxsans, Coast Salish, Nuuchaanalth, Tsimshian, we're all here to stay. And that we need, on a nation-to-nation basis, to respect each other and watch each other's back, support each other. But I don't know where you got that question, Alex, but the best thing I can think of is the ovoid. Because this is life, and it's choices. Every day in life, we have choices. You know, we have to choose between good and bad, right and wrong, black and white, you know. So the best symbol I think would recognize that is the ovoid. Because the ovoid, it captures in an elongated circle the tensions between those choices. How was that?
Thanks, Miles. So in a workshop in our community one time, and somebody used that word, and one of our young guys suggested it might be 20 cents, a paradigm.
Awesome. Paradigm, that's funny. I just got that joke. Good morning, Shauna Manson from Likes and First Nation. Thanks, Miles, for your presentation. Just wanted to caution us a little bit to not buy into the opposing rhetoric around the kind of governance that we're talking about in negotiations. It's absolutely not a municipality. Local governments only have authority to make laws about bylaws, land use, and city property taxes, and that we're definitely talking about a broader jurisdictional authority in our treaty than that. I just had to make that comment and ask the question, because I love listening to you speak, and I love hearing about the governance component. Folks that know me know that that's the area of work that I tend to focus most on. What do you do, or how, other than your charming personality, compel your neighbors, your colleagues, your relatives to want to participate in that broader governance vision? Because sometimes we can isolate ourselves and begin to focus, because it's like you said, it's easier, right? You can get your ducks in a row, you can get your stuff done, and you can move forward. Meanwhile, five or six other communities that are your relatives that should be with you aren't. And how can you compel them to see the urgency of the need to come together for the betterment of all of us?
That is a really good question. And, you know, in terms of nationhood, that probably is the question. The will is what I referred to it in my remarks. You gotta have the will. But in pursuing that, I don't think there's any other answer than leadership matters. You have to have leaders that believe in your nationhood. And when, I know when the Haida Nation started, that was a long time ago. I wasn't even 30 years old. But, you know, I don't know, for some reason I could speak about things passionately and could listen and hear people. You know, for 10 years with the hereditary chiefs, it wasn't just, there was a lot of young leaders who listened to the elders, who really tried to understand what our culture taught us about our responsibilities and our relationship to place and what our values are as a people. And then we articulated that, and mainly the hereditary leaders stood up, but in those days, even the band councils did. You know, it all hasn't always been so. But for those first 10 years when we're building our constitution, defining the major areas that we had to get under our control, we had almost total unity. You know, as a young leader, I thought that's just the way the world was gonna be. And little did I know, as mistrust crept in, you know, the other, the band council structure got threatened. Just a little thing, Shanna, like, and every one of you experienced this. You want your education system to be under your nation's policies, but the money in your community is for an education worker and system that responds to BC's policies. Now you move in and attempt to put those under your nation's policies, you got a battle between families and between people fighting to the death for their entrenched control over a little budget. Those are the battles you have to win for your nationhood to succeed. If you get lazy and just walk away because it's too tough to do, you're never going to get over that hump. And I'll tell you, there's some of these battles I'm talking to you about that still in the Haida Nation, we're done great on the bigger ones. On these little ones, it's those are the ones that are going to make the difference, and you have to prevail. The only way you can get over that is with committed leadership, with a define your vision. And one thing that I talked about last year that really helped is one thing that our young leaders did, and many of your nations have done that, is we took our oral tradition, our oral governance, and put it into a written modern constitution. And you know, we did things like we passed our own legislation. And you talk about the, today we have a land use agreement with BC over 100% of our territories. Nothing happens there without our consent. When we started that, we passed Haida legislation under our constitution and just persuaded our people in our annual meetings. And there were Donnybrooks over people who had vested interests in the areas we were trying to protect. But enough people believed in our nationhood to get them through. And you know what? At the end of the day, our legislation proved more powerful than federal and provincial. Federal and provincial in the intervening years have adjusted their legislation to come into line with ours. And that was just through force of will. I see on the agenda here, we have next the Nishka, the Northern Shuswap and Yukon. It'd be fascinating to hear some of their experiences, how they did that. They're out ahead in these issues and get some different ideas. But that's it comes down to simple but tough battles like that. I'd love to hear the Nishka stories.